Hello, my name is Chad Lehman. This is a recording of our LipSync Buildathon presentation. This can be used to help you have a successful LipSync Buildathon event. These are the slides that were used on December 3rd, 2019 for the United Nations Day of Persons with Disability and the LipSync Buildathon event that happened in New Brunswick. So Makers Making Change is a project of the Neil Squire Society. Makers Making Change looks to connect makers to people with disabilities who need assistive technologies. Makers Making Change is just one program, the Neil Squire Society. Neil Squire Society has programs around employment, assistive technology accommodations, around computer and digital literacy, our Makers Making Change, which is also part of our innovation and research and development, as well as many other partners and programs that we collaborate with. Funding for Makers Making Change that was originally made possible by the Google Foundation, winning a 2016 Google Innovation Award. Our core funding comes from the Government of Canada through Innovation, Science, and Economic Development. And this Buildathon project was sponsored by the Craig H. Nielsen Foundation, which covered the cost of parts of the lip syncs. And the event was hosted and funded through the National Accessibility Week by the Government of Canada and the New Brunswick Premier's Council on Disabilities. It's amazing to have so many funders to help us bring many of these projects from our laboratories into the lives of people with disabilities through the support of these partners and you volunteering here today. So just to give you a bit of history, I'm not sure if you know who this is, but this is Terry Fox. In the late 70s, early 80s, Terry lost his leg to cancer. But 2 years later, to help raise awareness about cancer and the abilities of people with disabilities, he started the Marathon of Hope, where every day he ran a full marathon. He did this for 150 consecutive days until the cancer spread throughout the rest of his body and he passed. A friend of Terry's at the wheelchair hospital in Vancouver, GF Strong, was Rick Hansen. Rick Hansen was inspired by Terry's work and continued on with Terry's vision. Over the course of 2 years in the mid-80s, Rick Hansen literally wheeled around the world. This started to change the conversation around what do we do with people with disabilities to how do we enable people with disabilities. So look what people with disabilities can do when they're the proper accommodations. Also in the rehab hospital with Neil and with Rick was a man named Neil Squire. Neil Squire was a young university student and got in a car accident and broke his neck at the C1, C2 level. He survived the accident, but the quality of his life, of course, drastically changed. He had no ability to move his arms, his legs, and quite often had very difficult time speaking, spoke in a whisper, if any sort of cough or fluid, had a difficult time speaking at all. So here you have this bright young man, literally trapped in his body in the hospital bed. A family cousin, second cousin, Bill Cameron, much like an uncle to Neil, went to visit Neil in the rehab hospital and saw his condition and thought, there's got to be more we can do for Neil. There has to be a better quality of life for him. So hired a couple summer students, and they took, at this time, Sip and Puff technology, and they taught that to Neil and taught him Morse code. So Neil could sip and puff on a tube, and those become dots and dashes. They then connected that Morse code machine and wrote some software to connect it to an Apple IIe computer. So Neil, by sipping puffing on that tube, could fully control that computer. He could enter commands, write letters, print documents. It really gave him his voice back and ability to sort of communicate. Other people at the rehab hospital saw what Neil was doing. They started asking for accommodations, and this is how the Neil Squire Society was born. The product that Neil used has gone through some evolutions. There's a commercial product that is very similar to this called the Jouse. It uses the same sip and puff technology, but more emulates a mouse. When we went away from sort of a text-based sort of input on computers to a graphical user interface with mice, the Jouse basically emulated the mouse, so you can move that joystick up, down, left, right, and you can sip and puff to left click, right click. As I said, this is still a commercially available product. You can see here, here's Don Danbrook, who's been a volunteer at the Neil Squire for a number of years. Using the Jouse to control a mouse cursor on his computer. And as well, you can see a microphone. So it's using in conjunction speech recognition. And together, those work quite powerfully. You can use speech recognition for majority of your sort of text input. We still have that mouse for sort of fine movement, clicking and navigating through websites. So while the Joust is a great product, there are some flaws with it. It is quite large, it's expensive, it's about $1,500 American, and it has a big box that plugs into a wall to power the device, which means it's not going to be a great solution for that phone in your pocket, unless you want to be stuck plugged into the wall all the time. So Neil Squire saw a call that Google had out around innovations for people with disabilities. So we pitched Google to like reimagine the Joust to be something that would work on mobile portable electronics and to release it open source so it was more easily to be built and freely available to people to kind of build their own. So here you have an exploded view of the Joust. Again, it's basically a mouse that you use with your mouth, but all the controls are housed in the head of the unit, which means you can connect it, you can plug it into your phone, tablet, computer. We even have software now so it can work with an Xbox as a joystick. So in building the LipSync, you use a number of different tools. I'm going to walk through some of these here and some more detail here. The primary tool you'll be using is soldering iron and solder. Other tools that you have available will be flush cutters to cut components. You'll be doing some gluing. Maybe I'm using the solder sucker to help fix some soldering errors along the way. Some prime safety things that you should be aware of. Solder quite often does have lead in it. So when you're done soldering, you should wash your hands. The exposure is very low level, but you wouldn't want to be eating food after soldering. You want to wash your hands. The other primary soft safety piece is to wear safety goggles to protect your eyes from both the soldering iron, but sometimes when you cut components with the flush cutters, little pieces kind of pop and shoot. So just make sure that you're safe and protect your eyes. Finally, if you do have long hair, you may want to tie it back so you don't singe it with the soldering iron. So when you solder, most of the soldering you do for the LipSync, you're doing through-hole soldering, which means you put a component through leg through the hole, and then on the other side, you solder it to the PCB board. So the way you do this is you apply the soldering iron tip to the component where the metal pad is, where it goes through, and you heat that for a second or two. That makes the component warm, hot, and then you can apply solder. Hold the solder there for a second or two to make sure the solder goes all the way around the joint, and then remove the solder, but still keep the soldering iron still there. What this should do is the solder will sink a little bit more into the joint of the PCB board, and create a sort of nice volcano looking effect, and then you can remove your soldering iron. So it's not a matter of applying both the iron and the solder to the component at this exact same second anymore. You heat the spot, apply some solder, move the solder away, but keep the heat there to make sure it's fully formed around the joint, and then remove the soldering iron. The more you do it, the better you get at it, and the better it'll start flowing. If you get some gunk, or it looks a little dirty on the edge of your soldering iron, you want to wipe it on the sponge on your soldering stand to clean that off. So I'm going to walk you through the build here. You may not remember this all. You may want to come back and review a little bit of this as you go. But there are great instructions off the Makers Making Change website. If you search for the LipSync, they kind of walk you through the build and the components and the steps you go through. So the first bit is you build the main PCB board. This is where the microcontroller, the Arduino, will eventually go onto, and also how the joystick connects to it, and how the SIP and PUF board connects to it. So this is all just through-hole soldering. You put the bits through, just make sure you're putting the components on the right side of the board as you go through. The second step is to build the SIP and PUF board. A couple little tips here are where I've seen people have gone wrong in the past. Those little yellow capacitors are actually unique and different. They have very small numbers on them, 103, 105, 471. And that's the order they go in on the board from left to right, 103, 105, 471. So that matters. Your LipSync won't work if those are backwards. The part that's maybe even trickier is the SIP and PUF board. It's the only part of the build where you're doing surface mount soldering. So you're not actually putting something through the hole, but there's little metal pads there that you solder it onto. So you just want to make sure, this picture's a little blurry, but you want to make sure when you solder it that the pad and the leg of the SIP and PUF board are connected and flat. If there's a gap between them at all as you solder, there will be poor connectivity and you'll get very sporadic behaviors at lip sync. And you'll want to make sure that that part is done well before you put on some other header pins on the side, because then it's hard to get at. So I recommend that if you have other people there that maybe soldered before, as you kind of finish each step, call someone over, have them take a look and make sure they kind of got through the SIP and things look in place. The next step is combining those two boards. So kind of you put the SIP of puff board and use some header pins to connect it to the main board. The common part that I see people may get wrong here is they put the SIP of puff board on the wrong side. You want to make sure it kind of goes under where all those other components are from the other step. That'll be important later on. The next step is adding the header pins so you can connect your Arduino microcontroller to the main board. There's a lot of soldering, 17 pins on each strip, so it's 34 solder joints that you'll do there. At this point, you'll be a grizzled veteran. Again, you want to make sure you put those on the right side of the board. These ones are very difficult to remove if you get them on the wrong side. The more difficult part of the build is building the joystick mechanism. This isn't a standard joystick that you see on a video game controller, for example. The early versions of the LipSync actually tried to use that, but we found it had too much distance and throw and not enough detail in the sort of core centerpiece, which made it difficult for people with high-level spinal cord injuries to use. So there's a couple tricks with this that you should be aware of. First of all, there's 3D printed components that are part of your joystick. When you put this lure lock into this threaded piece here, you want to make sure in this 3D printed part, there's no extra support material and that black bit gets almost flush down into it. And then when you screw this white bit in, you're going to want to crazy glue this white lure lock to that black nut there. It's very important. If that's not glued and that continues to spin after it's assembled, the hose that connects the sip and puff can kink. So like a garden hose, when you have a kink, the water can't get through. If you have a kink in your air hose, the sip and puff will no longer work. So make sure you apply some glue between that white piece and the black piece to kind of hold it together. The part that gives most people the difficulty are these little components you see sticking off this board here. These are the FSRs, force sensing resistors. Essentially, the LipSync has four of them, one for up, one for down, one for right, one for left. So when a pressure is applied on one of those, it feeds the voltage through and tells the cursor to move in that direction. But these are very finicky pieces. They melt very easy to heat. And if they crease, it can kind of affect the connectivity as well. So we have a couple tips to help you with this. One, there's a 3D printed stand that that's available off our website that you can kind of put that board on in the top, and it has a nice little slot that holds that FSR at a nice angle for you to solder, to kind of go around and solder all four. This makes your build significantly easier. The other part that we've seen people sometimes do wrong is essentially you peel off this clear backing and the black part of the FSR is like a sticker and you stick it on the outline on the 3D print. Sometimes people peel not just the clear plastic off, but the whole black pad off. That ruins the connectivity and basically makes the FSR garbage. So make sure you just peel off the clear bit and not the black piece, and then stick it properly on the ring. When you have these through, they should look like this. You see how they're a nice rounded archway go through? If they look more kind of like a sharp angle, like more like a letter V sort of angle as opposed to a rounded U, that crease can sometimes affect the connectivity and the quality of your joystick. So just as you pull these through, make sure they're rounded and don't turn it upside down and apply a lot of pressure that can kind of crack those leads, okay? Once you have your joystick built and you get the components in, we can give you some help getting those 3D buttons and springs in the back, and we'll get it into the case of the piece. One of the parts that you have the option of doing is registering your device. So this allows us to know who made the device, and it lets you know who eventually we gave this device to. So it's a real chance for you to stay engaged, help us in tracking who made these devices, where they're made, and help us tell people where they got to. At the end, you should have a working LipSync. Because these were all paid for by our great funders of the event, these will all go free of charge to people in the community that benefit from this device. So even a local rehab hospital or someone that you know that may benefit from this device, please talk to us. We'd be happy to connect them. Thank you for your time. If you have any questions, my name is Chad Lehman. I'm the Director of Innovation for the Neil Squire Society. My email is chadl@neilsquire.ca, and you can find out more about the great work of the Neil Squire Society at neilsquire.ca and the many open source, freely available projects supported by the Neil Squire at our website, makersmakingchange.com. It's a repository where you can share projects, borrow projects, and find people with disabilities in your community that you can help support. Thank you very much for your time.